Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Dorkside Cookies, The Ingredients. In these videos, we open up a game, set it up, maybe play a round or two, and kind of explain things as we're going with the intention that if you wanted to, you could literally take out your own copy of the game, open up this video, and just be pausing it as you're doing things, and completely be ready to play with your friends. Now, this game is big. This is Scythe. It is probably game of the year. It's definitely one of the most talked about games of 2016. And it is really awesome. I'll be honest, I kickstarted it and I forgot about it. People kept talking about it. And I kept being like, I already paid for it. Click, 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 like click past. And I didn't get it. And part of why I didn't get it is because you've got this picture of like European peasants in front of Mecca. And I like Mecca, but I'm not really big into World War II, World War I type of things. And I really get this impression of that type of setting. This is an alternate history where it's more steampunk and the countries are kind of squished together or whatever because it's, you know, it's a board game. Then I got it and I opened it. Let's go ahead and open it. I opened it and this mega box was filled to the brim with stuff. And I closed it and I said, I don't have the mental fortitude to handle a game this big right now. I was like, I need a whole day. It was after work, like on a Wednesday. I was going to invite, you know, my buddies over and we were going to do it. And I was like, no, I should have. It's really not a big deal. It's a big game, but they did everything so well that I think it's pretty easy. So let's go ahead and start pulling everything out. Now, this is the premium edition. It's what I got from the Kickstarter. I would think more of you have premium editions or similar like upper level editions than not. I don't really know which parts are only premium edition. Kickstarter things confuse me, and I just assume that most of you got your stuff from Kickstarter. What is nice is, as far as I can tell, the premium edition probably only added special, like upgraded components, and not necessarily too many new rules that aren't already there. And you can't really tell, or I can't tell, the things that I have that I wouldn't have had if I didn't have the premium edition. One thing is these amazing metal coins. If you don't have the premium edition and you have standard cardboard coins, it's fine. There's nothing wrong with them. These things though, listen to them. It just sounds right and they look cool. And everybody who's seen this game so far, they comment on the coins. They like them. I've started pulling back from, you know, choosing the Kickstarter options that just give me an upgraded component of a game I'm only going to have time to play two or three times because it's just going to sit in a box up in my library. But the coins are cool. I don't know how much I paid extra for this, but it's probably worth it. All right. So, I'll go ahead and describe things as I pull them out. And again, you could probably start setting up the game immediately. I'm going to describe them just so you know what they are. So when you go back to them later. So you've got one will for every faction. And the wills, if you're familiar with games like X-Wing and things, you're going to set this number secretly whenever you get into combat. And then you're going to secretly put it, well, not secretly, but you're going to put it face down without them knowing what number you put. And then you simultaneously flip it and you say, aha, I paid, well, like one power from my nation. And either you're trying to win the battle by overwhelming them by paying like, you know, 5, 6, 7, or you're trying to fake them out. You get into a battle and you put yourself at zero, hoping they've wasted their nation's resources, something like that. So that's what these do. These red cards with the little pigeon or dove with a little message, these are secret objectives. Everybody gets 2 starting the game. Obviously the coins. You have, this is a quasi, so it's, they call it a 4X strategy game, but there's definitely a lot of sort of Euro style components to it. And these tiles are a bonus objective that just gives everybody another way to get points. And it can really change how people play the game, depending on which of these tiles come up in any particular game. You've got a nice stack of helper cards. We're gonna get that more into that later, but these cards basically summarize virtually everything you need to know from the rule book on a general basis. And then they give you a single summary sheet that has the rest. And you, I don't think anybody's really needed to look at the rules short of those things. So these are really cool. All right. Now, I'm not sure which of you got these. These can be really confusing if you're trying to play the game. These are, they're not mentioned in the rules. And so you get this and you're like, what do I use these for? Well, there's another rule book for playing the game solo. And even on the front, it has the icon, Atoma Factory. These guys generated some cards to help automate the other faction. Maybe other factions, I'm not really sure there. But basically, they, you know, the game will play itself, allowing you to play solo with challenges. And there's different levels of challenge and things like that. I think it's really cool. I haven't done it yet, but don't get confused by these cards. Just, I put them all in a bag and I put them to the side. And I said, one day I will, you know, maybe everybody will, I'll be waiting for everyone to show up and they won't. And then I'll be like, that's fine. Atoma Factory, boom, I'm playing. That's not today. Except it should be because I'm here. But it's not, I'm not by myself. I'm here with you guys. So there you go. All right. There's these little brown tokens that have pictures of resources with plus ones and plus threes. And all these do is allow you to not have to put a big pile of resources on a square. You can actually just put these on there. Basically, you know, like it's like, you know, you're out of ones. So you start telling everybody at the game, hey, everyone, can you switch up to fives or tens? That's all these are. So you don't even really, we have not needed them so far, but our games, we tend to be kind of aggro and we end the game early. All right. These tokens are what you're going to use to indicate that there's still an encounter left in a hex waiting to be discovered or encountered. Okay. These clips, unless you bought the expansion board, you don't need them. But I've saved them just in case I decide to buy the bigger board. We'll put those aside for the moment. Each faction comes with 2 little bags of components. I've started putting them into single bags. I just don't really see a big reason to have them be in 2 little bags, but that's how they come. All right, the random encounter deck. These are really cool. I like them a lot. Some people don't care about them. Some people, it's how much do you want your pure skill to win the game, and how much do you really want to see, you know what, can I get something cool by going to that square? I love these things, but that's what they are, the green, or the encounter deck. Unique upgrades, these are called the factory cards. So they are they're sort of purplish, and there's a limited number every game. So we've only played twice so far. We're gonna play a third this week. And that means that we don't know what upgrades are still out there. I specifically don't wanna look at them. I wanna be surprised, because there's enough of these. If you only pull out the number of players plus one per game, that means that you can really play like five or six games before you've, you know, used up all the factory cards. I think that's cool. All right, combat cards are people fighting on a yellow deck, another small deck. The resources, at least for me, came with these little plastic containers. So, it's kind of cool. Could have been in a bag, but I think this is convenient. You have 10 small sideboards. 3, 4, 5. And each player is going to get one of these randomly. I guess you could choose or something if you don't want it to be random. But by default, you give everybody one of these randomly and one of these. And then they're effectively playing that combination combined. So you're not just the Russians. You're the patriotic Russians, or the industrial Russians, or the mechanical Russians. And these two combinations entirely change the game. So I played a faction and everybody thought I had like the easy button. So when I dominated them, they're like, yeah, of course, because you got the easy combination. But we hadn't seen it before. It wasn't like it was obvious that it was easier. And I don't think it was really easier. Like, I saw them missing out on opportunities. But that's also something that makes the game a little bit harder to master, is each faction plays differently. And if you feel like by the end of a game you have a really good, strong understanding, that actually might mess you up the next game, because you try to play the next game the same way, but that next game, that next faction doesn't work the same way, which I think is good. All right. So this little plastic container has the different factions, right? So they went ahead and they didn't just do colors, entirely different minis. And these minis do not look cheap. This is a guy riding a war oxen, water buffalo. I don't know, one of those big beasts of labor. Here's a guy with a bear. There's a guy with falcons. Guy with wolf, a guy with a dire panther. I mean, this is a big cat. Anyway, that's your leader. And then your mecha are each variations of kind of like World War I style tanks, but with legs. So we'll just put those on the side. And rule book and Automa rules. Just put all those aside. Don't need those for the moment. And the board. Oh, I do want to point out that they printed out their recommended way of putting the contents back in the box. I appreciate that. You get all this stuff. I don't want to feel like it's a jigsaw puzzle that I'm trying to solve just to put the game away. Just tell me. This is awesome. Thank you, guys. Stonemaier Games. They're the guys who made this. So, awesome. Love it. All right, so we're going to go ahead and set it up for two-player play. All right, so one thing, this is a big game. In terms of like big, you're going to see how quickly it is to set it up, but I have a 5-foot by 8-foot custom table, and yet it still does a good job of filling up the space. You're definitely going to want to be aware of that before you try to set it up and end up overloading your table and not having space to put stuff on. If you have a smaller table, you probably already compensated with TV trays or something, but for us, even this is just a big game. There's no way to get around it. All right, so let's do it. So first of all, you're going to want to take your factory cards. You're going to want to shuffle it, you know, whatever. And you're going to want to deal out the number of players plus one. So 1, 2, 3 for two players. Then you're going to want to put out the combat cards. You know, shuffle, of course. You want to put out the encounter cards. Even if you've played it a couple times, I still recommend giving out the summary cards. So you would give out one of these, one of each of these to each player. And what you'll find is while the quick start suggestions gives you advice on how to play the game in the very beginning, the other side is vital to not getting confused what can do which. Totally. You're going to want this in the beginning, and you're going to want it later on as you just, you know, trying to remember a specific thing that maybe you haven't been using, you're wondering why you're losing, whatever. This is, you know, this is going to have stuff there. What I found is that this little map, which shows which factions can cross which types of terrain, is actually more useful on your second or third game than it is on your first. Because on the first, you don't really understand the significance of how the movement works in this game. I mean, you can be told, I can tell you, you can watch these videos. I think most of the time, this is more interesting or more valuable once you're better at the game. And then the other side shows how combat works and how moving into terrain works. This is everything you need to know. I mean, these two cards, that's it. You're wondering something. It's been a month since you last played. You're just kind of like, you want a refresher. You could look in the rule book. The rule book is great. These are perfect though. All right. Now, if you've watched me set up a lot of these, you know, these games, one thing you'll notice is that while in other games, I literally want to keep out the setup so that I don't forget anything. And I don't think it does a service to you to pretend that I can just memorize those, you know, those other games that have very eccentric sort of setup rules. I could act like I can just memorize it, but I don't. This game, I don't need to pretend, and I'm not. It's that easy. You just fill up everything in the spaces that they belong in, and then you start playing. So you have these encounter symbols. Make sure that every tile that has the little like navigation star has a navigation token. And then you're good. All right, you're going to shuffle the objectives, and you might as well just go ahead and give two to each player. I don't really know why the objectives get put into this space, because you can't normally get any more in the middle of the game. I assume there might be an encounter that lets you switch out an objective. I haven't found it, if so. All right. Okay. So at this point, we randomly deal out a faction and a player board to each player. So, player on the left has the mechanical resviets. And the player on the right has the patriotic Crimeans. So, again, this is like an alternate Europa where things are similar but slightly different. All right, so this is as far as you can get until you have these boards, and then you can start doing the rest of player setup. So, number one, you're gonna wanna grab the colors for each board. The mecha, generally the way the game works is red things usually are a cost you have to pay and you want to cover up. And anything else are things that like you get. Well, green things, you get something, and so you want to uncover if they start with the game blocked. And things that are not green and not red, they just do something, usually for something. So when you start the game, your faction has four mecha special abilities, but they're covered by mecha. So until you build the mecha, you don't get those special abilities. One of the most vital special abilities every faction has is an ability called Riverwalk, which allows Mecha to cross certain types of rivers. In this case, the Resviets, they can move across rivers to farms and villages. So they can cross a river to a farm or to a village, which means they can't go across all rivers, just certain ones. The Crimeans, they can cross rivers to farms and tundra. Okay. And you're going to want to take the hero and put it on their big symbol. So the red hero goes on his Resviet symbol, and the Crimeans have their hawk guy start on the yellow thing, and then you're going to want to give them their, you know, their color token bag, red and red, just red, and then you're going to want to give them their power wheel. Red and yellow. then your player faction, it's going to tell you to put your power on a certain place. So your power represents your military might. And that's something that's very important in the game, is that military might is represented by sort of your nation as a whole, and not necessarily so much by your individual units. All right, so you're going to have a symbol that we call the bug. This is the bug. Other people might want to call it like sort of an eagle flag kind of thing, maybe with arrows and stuff like that. We call it the bug. It kind of reminds me of a Spider-Man tracer, something like that. All right, so the bug for the Respiates starts on the number 3. And for the Krimians, the bug starts at 5. Now, what that looks like then is that the Krimians have a very strong military nation starting out, and the Respiates have a weaker nation. However, I said power represents the nation's combat strength, right? Well, the Respiates start with 2 combat cards. The combat cards represent what the army units themselves contribute to battle. So the Respiates start at a 3 power for their nation. However, they have 2 cards so that one unit can fight in 2 different battles, or 2 units can fight in the same battle, whatever. And for example, this set, he got a 4 and got a 2. So technically in one battle, if he had 2 units, the Respiate player could actually, starting off the, you know, just right off the bat, have 6, 7, 8, 9 power to work with, which is going to crush the Krimians, because the Krimians start with 0 combat strength. So the army units for the Krimians, at least in the beginning of the game, have nothing to contribute to the power of a military victory. It's just 100% the nation and its force. So that's something I think is interesting. You can choose to get more combat cards, meaning that now you have more things to spend on your units, or you can choose to increase the military might of your nation, which means that everybody else can see how much power you're building up, but it's there. And it's a little bit less random than hoping that you got a 4 instead of a bunch of 2s. Also, you can bluff with these cards easier than you can with the power on the board. But then that is what the will is for, because they don't know how much power you're going to spend. You attack the Krimian player and he's got a 5. The Respiate player might think to themselves, okay, they're going to crush me. But then the Krimian puts 0 and the Respiate puts a bunch of his combat cards and now he's tapped out, right? So that's just kind of cool. All right, so you have the bugs on the power tracker. And then you're going to want to just keep looking through. All right, you handed out the combat cards. And now when you look at the player mat, it's almost perfect what you put. In fact, if we just, first off, go ahead and put down 1 worker. Worker look like little meeples. So little people, meeples. Put them on the 2 land masses next to your symbol. Boom. Then what you have left will all go on your boards and you should have nothing left over. If you do have something left over, then you're probably not covering something properly. So right off the bat, let's go ahead and grab our 6 stars. So each faction has 6 stars of their color. And put it just somewhere on your faction board.
And next, just go ahead and find, like, everything else has a home on your player mat. So your little monument, it looks like a little like Taj Mahal or something. It goes on your monument space. Now, every player mat is different. So when you're setting it up, what you're seeing might be different than what I'm seeing. Just know that there is a monument square somewhere and put that there. And then the octagon is your armory. It's like an octagonal cylinder. And then you have four circles, which represent you enlisting troops. What's a little bit strange about these troops is that they actually do not fight. They just represent a growth in the troops of your nation, maybe, but they actually don't, they don't ever fight in a battle per se. I did leave one thing out. You have hearts. Go ahead and put the hearts wherever your player faction mat or player mat says to put it. So the mechanical Rusviets start with a 3 in popularity, and the patriotic Crimeans, they have a 2 in popularity. You should have 6 workers left. And you put those just directly on your produce space, wherever that is. You should have 6 little spaces for workers, and they should fit perfectly in the top. And what that's doing is when you start the game, they cover the costs of running your nation. So you can just produce stuff. But as you grow your nation and you have more workers to maintain, it actually starts costing you more and more to run your production engine of your factory. Which I think is very clever. Just in my opinion. All right, missed another one. You're going to want to put your little action token. Just put it, you know, somewhere. Don't put it on your board. It'll be confusing later. Boom. All right. You have a mine. It looks like an upside down U. And a windmill. And then you should be left with 6 technology cubes. The way the technology cubes work is they start the game on the top, covering up upgrades for your technology, for your civilization. As you upgrade your nation, you're going to move these technology cubes from the top to the bottom, and that will simultaneously give you something new to gain on the top. And it will simultaneously remove a cost from your bottom. And what that does is it makes the game very, very different, or very, it's not different. What it does is it makes the game play very differently each time, because every time you play the game, you could choose to upgrade your ability to trade and make it so that you're more efficient at enlisting troops. So from one side of the board to the other, wherever you want to put it, it just goes from the top, covers up the bottom. You're simultaneously getting 2 benefits, and it's up to you to do it at the right time to get the most benefit from throughout the game. I think it's a very cool concept. I sort of have a game player crush on the designer of this game. I mean, I have a lot of respect for this game. I just think it's amazing. All right. So at this point, you each have a power board, you each have your tokens, you each have whatever number of combat cards you're supposed to have. you have your two factions. These number of faction cards, by the way, are listed on your player mat. If at some point in an expansion they give you more player mats, there may be different numbers of objectives, secret objectives. Maybe a faction has more secret objectives or one that has none. So, you know, something like that. They're all listed on your player mat. You also have a certain number of starting currency. So what I would always recommend, just like any game, is to make sure to give yourself some singles so that you can make change for smaller expenses. Like in this case, the Rusviets, the mechanical Rusviets start with 6. So I'm going to give them 3 ones and a 3. And how interesting is that? A 3. But they, you know, they obviously know that you're going to want some ones and that you don't want a 1 and a 5, because then you're going to immediately break the 5 anyways. And that's going to use up a lot of ones. The 3 is perfect. All right. And then the other faction also has 6. So they're also going to have 3 ones. And these ones look like sort of Chinese coins, right? They even have the little hole in the middle so you can thread them on a necklace, you know, kind of thing. 3, and then 3. And the threes look, you know, maybe kind of Roman. I feel like it looks kind of Roman. All right. Now that's the setup. You do have the resources. Go ahead, and if you have the premium edition where you have these little boxes, just just put them like so. Like that. Okay, so you're just gonna want those to be available when you start the game, and you're ready to start. Each player mat has a different number, and the lower the number, that's who starts the game. In this case, the Patriotic Crimeans, they start with a lower number, which means that everybody else has a little bit extra to compensate for not being able to go as fast, right? Now, the objective to ending the game, right? Like a lot of Euro-style games, ending the game is different from winning the game. You should not want to end the game unless you think you're going to win the game, but two different things. And a lot of times, the person who ends the game is not the person who wins the game. All right, so to end the game, one player must put all 6 of their stars in the objective area of the board. So that's supposed to be your goals. And the more stars you have out when you end the game, the more bonus points you're going to get, which means the person who ends the game does have a slight advantage in points, because they will inherently have 6 stars out, and the most anybody else can have is 5. So some of the objectives, they're all pretty clear. If you have upgraded all 6 of your technology cubes, then that is a star. If you build all 4 mecha, that's a star. If you've built all 4 of your buildings, that's a star. If you've upgraded all 4 of your militia, that's a star. If you've put all 8 of your workers off the board onto the mat, then that's worth a star. If you've completed one of your 2 objectives, if you complete an objective, you discard the other one and it's gone. Well, normally. The Britons, the Saxons, they're able to complete both objectives. If you win a combat, you get a star. You can only get that reward twice. So you can get, you win a combat, you put a star over here. You win another combat, you can put another star over here. That's the most you can get. Again, unless you're Saxons, whose special ability is to be able to get these things more than once. All right. If you get your popularity all the way to the max, 18 popularity, you can get a star. And if you can get your power all the way to the max, you get a star. So those are the ways that you can get a star. Pretty clear, remove all of one type off your board. You get a little bit closer to ending the game. Now, how do you win the game though, right? I mean, that's really what you should be playing towards. The only thing you want to keep in mind, even if your goal is just, I'm going to play better than everybody else, that's my goal. The game can end whenever it ends. You kind of have to keep an eye on it because you could easily be passed up by somebody else who's playing a long game and you might have been winning for a while, but because you failed to end it, then maybe you didn't win. So just got to keep that in mind. A lot of times the slower players will do better in a longer game. Because there's only so many points you can accrue. Okay, so the way that you win the game is at the very end of the game, you count your money. Ultimately, that's it. The amount of money you have determines who wins. But you get bonus money depending on where you're at on a couple different measurements of success. So number one, the amount of bonus points you get for any given, the amount of bonus points each of these things are worth is determined off of your popularity. So there's three brackets, and the first bracket, which everybody starts in, says, 3, 2, and 1, for the bonus points, and the second tier is 4, 3, and 2, and then the third tier is 5, 4, and 3. It makes a huge difference. It's a big enough difference that generally, if you have to pay popularity to do something, and it's going to move you into a lower bracket, be very cautious because if the game ends, you're going to lose a lot of points. So what I try to do is I try to make sure that I never spend popularity if it's going to lower me one. And really, on the other hand, extra popularity at the end of the game does nothing for you. So do not fight to raise yourself. So like 7 is the first of the second tier. You've got to think to yourself, before you get any popularity at all, are you going to go to 13? Which is the third tier. Don't get 2 popularity and end the game at 9, because it doesn't do you any good. It's not worth anymore. 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 are all worth the same number of bonus points. So that's what I'm always thinking in my head. Before I push for more popularity, can I push all the way? And if not, I just don't worry about it. Or I just get enough to absorb any losses that I'm gonna do from workers or whatever. Okay, so the bonus points are for stars, and they're pretty heavy. Like in the first tier, every star you get is worth 3 coins. The number of hexagons on the map that you are in control of. So you start the game with 2 hexagons that you're in control of. So those are worth, 4 points in the beginning. Your symbol is not a hex. You don't have control of it. It's just vague, not real land. So everybody starts with 4 points. If you get into the second tier, those two tiles are worth 6 points each and so on. Then the amount of resources that you've put on the land is worth half of the points. So every two resources, like, three wood is worth 1 point. Four wood is worth 2 points, and so on. Something else that's kind of similar is if you control the center of the map, it shows a picture of three hexagons. So it's worth three hexagons. You don't really have to remember any of this kind of stuff because it's there. Boom. Another advantage of getting to the center is the first player to get to the center gets to look at the factory card. Well, okay, the first character for a player, right? So these are the characters, these are workers. So the first character or hero who gets to the center gets to look at all of the factory cards and pick one, and then the rest of the game, they have a unique advantage that only they have. And they blocked the other player from getting it because now the other player only has two left. There you go. So let's get these off. I talked about how to end the game. I talked about how to win the game. That's probably it. I'm gonna play through a round. Because this game is very different, but I think it's very easy, just very easy. It's just that things don't really necessarily make sense until you see how it works. All right, what you're gonna wanna do is you're going to want, at least your first couple games, to pull out the quick reference guide. This quick reference guide says, as far as I can tell, everything you need to know. And sometimes in the rule book, because it's explaining everything, and then we'll end with a caveat of, but this doesn't apply sometimes, blah. The quick reference guide has it right up front. So sometimes we've gotten into sort of debates over how something's supposed to work and whether something works a certain way, whatever. And we're looking through the rule book and then somebody will look at here and be like, no, it says very clearly that's how it works or that's how it doesn't work. It's amazing. You should pass this around for each player as they're going. That's something that I don't think it necessarily says that, but that's what you should do. Just pass this whole thing around to each player. They don't have to use it, but if they do need it, they have it. Just do it that way. This is not a game for one player to be the rules master. It really shouldn't be that way because what they want you to do is they want you to take your top row action, and I'll explain what that is in a moment, and then say they're going to do a bottom row action, but then it passes on to the next player. So the next player can do the bottom row action if they need to. I'm sorry. Okay. What they're going to want you to do, and the reason why one player shouldn't be responsible for everybody, you know, how to play the game, is because, you know, player one chooses a top row action, which I'll explain in a moment, and then they announce the bottom row action if they're doing it or not. But at that point, play normally moves on to the next player, and that next player can then choose a top row action while I'm finishing my bottom row action. And the reason why they said to do it that way is they said that the majority of the time, your bottom row action, other than announcing it so they know you're doing it, should not affect what they're doing. And it just makes the game a lot faster. Now, in the beginning, you may want to wait and watch, but until you, but after you get caught up and you know the rules, just move forward. There's like a magic in the game that I don't think it can quite capture. Like I said, when I first kickstarted this game, I actually wasn't that interested in it. It seemed like something that was like I have like three or four games upstairs that seemed kind of similar, but only the icons, like only the symbols and the hexes and stuff like that, that's what seems similar, but it's actually just so different. If you like Civilization type games, you know, 4X strategy games, you're going to like this game a lot, in my opinion. All of us like Civilization 4X strategy. So we kind of, like, we played two times in one night the other night. That happens never with our games. Except, for, like, none of our, like, big box games. We never played two games in one night because they're too big and too...